We may think of this subject as answered prayer or it may appear to us more to be pray with the ear and not the tongue. Our meditation before we start our class is a part of prayer. Many people have wondered why for centuries so much praying has taken place, so many millions of prayers and so many millions of churches, and so few answers. In my mail, I read every day the tragedy of people who pray for themselves and pray for their families, and then someone goes out and gets killed in an automobile accident, or somebody comes down with this disease or that disease, and they say, "What is wrong with my prayer?" Or, "I have tried to live a good life, a Christian life, a life of benevolence, for years and years and years, and I pray, and tragedy strikes my home just as much as the homes of those who do not pray. What is wrong with our prayers?" The answer is this. Prayers, regardless of how one prays, never reaches God unless before the prayer a contact is actually made with God. We are in the same relationship to God as an electrical appliance. It may be a beautiful appliance, complete and perfect, but until the connection is made with the electric current, it cannot operate. And you can pray from now until the next century, and it still would not operate unless an actual contact were made with the electric current. As human beings, we are branches of a tree that are cut off, and our prayers are worthless, regardless of how sincere, regardless of how deep, regardless of how philanthropical they may be. They are worthless unless first we have made contact with our source, unless we have first made contact with God. If you abide in the vine, and if you let these words abide in you, you will bear fruit richly. But if you do not abide in the vine, if you do not make actual contact with the source, you will be as a branch of a tree that is cut off and withereth, and praying will not help. It is for this reason that we meditate, not only before our classes and after our classes, and sometimes in between, but actually we meditate morning, noon, and night, and then in the middle of the night. And the further our students go in their spiritual advancement, the more they meditate, until eventually it is the normal thing to meditate 20 or 30 times a day, counting a day as a 24-hour period. Why? Because the mesmerism of this world, the radio, the newspaper, the television, the neighbors, the relatives, all of these pull us right out of our contact with God. They do not mean to. No. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. And I know their intentions are good, but they are disastrous. Because dwelling on the problems of the world and fearing them will not bring about answered prayer. Being anxious about the conditions of this world will not bring about answered prayer. Answered prayer has its basis in the Master's revelation that we are to take no thought for what we shall eat, nor what we shall drink, or wherewithal we shall be clothed. We are to take no thought for our life. We are to seek the realm of God. We are to seek the realization of God. We are to seek the kingdom of God, the realm of God, oneness with God, contact with God, whatever it is that establishes a oneness with our source. The meditation helps to establish that contact if the meditation is intelligently practiced. Meditation is exactly like prayer in that it must never contain a desire, it must never seek anything of God, it must carry no wish to God, not even the wish that my life might be saved, or my child's life be saved, or my country's life be saved, because this is such an utter waste of time that it does not even pay to take time to talk about it. You only have to review the history of the world since you are on earth to know that every parent has prayed to save its child, and every child has prayed to save its parents, and every man and woman in every country has been praying to save their particular country and their particular flag. What has happened to these prayers? You see, and this covers a tremendous subject that you must really see, God is not here to fulfill your desires or mine. God is not here to be your servant or mine. God does not exist to please you or me. God, under no circumstances, does anything for you or for me. And there is no way of compelling God to do for you or for me or for mine or for yours. The only correct approach to prayer and meditation is, not my will be done, but thine. Not do for me what I wish done, but prepare me to fulfill thy will. Let thy spirit be in me, that I may be a child of God, that I may be one with my Father, that I may dwell in the Father's house, and the Father dwell in me. God is not our servant, but it is fit that we be servants of God. God is not the Son of Man. It would be well if the Son of Man could be the Son of God. In every case, in our prayer and in our meditation, we must yield ourselves, our will, our desire to God, and let God fulfill His will, His grace in us. If we had not been incorrectly taught, there would be no fear about this. Unfortunately, many have been taught that God's will is sometimes evil, that sometimes God visits sickness on His children. It is even believed by some that God causes death. Of course, if one believes this, how can one trust oneself to God, not knowing but what God may decide to strike one down in this next minute? It is only when you can overcome the religious beliefs of the past 1700 years and begin to understand what Jesus taught 2000 years ago on the subject of God, that God's will is that man live. God's will is that man never know disease. God's will is that man never know accidents. God's will is that man never be punished for sin. When you stop to think how contrary this is to many of the older teachings, you will know why it is necessary to believe the Master when He tells us that you cannot add to a vessel already full. Unless you can empty yourself of all the old Judaic teachings which are now incorporated in the Christian Church, the old teachings of an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, the old teachings of vengeance, the old teachings of punishment for sin, unless you can clear yourself of those, you never can understand that God is love. And not only that God is love, the will of God is life eternal. The will of God is life harmonious. In Him there is no darkness at all. God is too pure to behold iniquity. There is no place in God for evil of any name or nature. And therefore, if we understand that in surrendering our will to God, we are surrendering ourselves to life eternal, we are surrendering ourselves to immortal life, spiritual life, perfect life, harmonious life, we will begin to understand that it is not a question of ill health or good health. It is a question of spiritual immortality when you surrender yourself to God. When you surrender yourself to God, there is no such thing as poverty, and there is no such thing as riches. There is the infinite abundance of allness, not a part, all. Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine, not a little corner of it. It is not a matter of a fence around a little land, and this is mine, or even a fence around a lot of land, and this is mine. It is a question of, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. All that you can use, and 12 baskets full left over. However, this can only be if you can accept God as love. This can only be if you begin to perceive the nature of God as God was revealed 2,000 years ago. If you can accept the fact that Jesus Christ did the will of God, then you will accept the fact that the will of God is health, abundance, harmony, peace, and forgiveness. For this is all you can find in the four Gospels on the subject of God and God's law. All the rest has been added by man. It is the same way if you can follow the Master on the subject of prayer. You will note that even at the tomb of Lazarus, he does not pray that Lazarus be lifted up, but he says rather, I do not have to pray. If you follow the Master with a crippled man, you will notice he does not pray for his recovery. He merely affirms that there is no other power than the power of God. Always on the subject of prayer, you will not find the Master asking God for anything unless it be light or bread. And by bread, you know he did not mean baker's bread, because he explained the subject of bread very clearly. I am the bread. Bread is the spiritual substance of life. Bread is the word of God. Man shall not live by bread alone, therefore he would not waste his time praying for that kind of bread. But the bread he prayed for was every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. When we give up this time-wasting praying to God for baker's bread or butcher's meat, and realize that the bread and the meat and the wine and the water that the Master prayed for was divine grace, and he did not pray that God give it to us, heavens, that would be acknowledging that God is withholding it from us. There again do you see how, in order to pray aright, we must know the nature of God? How can we pray to a God that we believe is withholding something and is going to give it up after we just hound him hard enough or long enough? Ah, no, there is no withholding God. There is no God withholding anything from us. And there is no God going to give us anything. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God is the same from everlasting to everlasting. All that God is doing today, God has been doing always, and will always continue to do, because the nature of God is. God is. God is. Not God was, and not God will be. God is. It is as much as if we were to pray, for sunshine. We do not pray for sunshine to come in. Open the windows, open the shades, and let it in. But to believe for a moment that God withholds the sun, or God withholds the rain, this is not to understand God. This is not to understand prayer. Again, because of these erroneous concepts of God and of prayer, we are very apt to believe that we can go on being the same kind of a human being we were yesterday or a year ago, and then just ask God for His grace and it will flow. No, the kind of human beings we have been has been the very barrier that has kept us from omnipresent grace. And in order to come into the experience of God's grace, there has to be a change in our nature. This is one of the biggest functions of prayer, to change our nature, that we may die daily and be reborn of the Spirit, that we may be renewed by the transforming of our mind, or that we may be transformed by the renewing of our mind. You see, when the woman taken in adultery was told, "Neither do I condemn you," do you know what had happened before that? She had turned to the Master. That was quite a change in her life. That represented a whole change of attitude, a whole change of desire, a whole change of being. Just the act of turning to the Master was enough to say, as if she had written it in a book, "I am through with yesterday. I want no part of it. That part of me is dead. I am now turning to you for light, for life, for regeneration." And with that he could say, "Neither do I condemn thee." He could not have said, "Neither do I condemn thee," to the woman of the day before. Now think of the thief on the cross as he turns to the Master. The Master says, "This night I will take you with me into paradise." Could he have said that to that thief the night before? No. First there had to be a turning on the part of the thief, as much as to say, "Cleanse me. I turn to you for renewal, purification. I know the old way was wrong, and I know it is dead in me." And then the Master could say, "There will be no waiting. This very night I will take you with me into paradise." Each one of us is the woman taken in adultery and the thief on the cross in some degree. Each one of us is harboring human emotions, negative or positive. Each one of us is harboring greed or lust or malice or revenge or something in some degree. And then without even a desire for cleansing, we pray, "God, save me. God, give me. God, do for me." And the answer does not come. Let us, within ourselves, acknowledge, regardless of how good we may have been as humans, let us acknowledge with Paul that I am not claiming to really have arrived at perfection. So I am asking for grace. I am asking for purification. I am asking that my old way be ruled out of me. Then when we do this, we have no occasion to pray to God for health or for supply or for companionship or for home, because in that moment of purification, all of these things are added unto us. God is Spirit. We are told that God knoweth our needs before we do. If God knew our needs for human things before we do, we would have them. There would be no necessity for praying. God does not know whether we need an automobile or a new house. God knows our need like the sunshine knows the need of the earth. It knows that the sun must shine, and that is what it knows. And God knows that God must be God. Therefore, as God is, God is fulfillment. Think of this. Without asking the sun for light or for warmth, the sun is light and warmth. When you have the sun, you have light and you have warmth. That is all you need, is the sun. You do not need light and warmth. You need the sun, for the sun is light and warmth. You do not need food and clothing and housing and transportation. You need God. And in having God, you find God as the health of my countenance. God is the bread and the meat and the wine and the water. God is instantaneity. God is where I am. And God is forever saying, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. Do you not see, then, that before there can be answered prayer, there must first of all be an awareness of the nature of God? There must be an understanding that we are not going to God for something, that we are not inferring that God is withholding something, that we are going to God in the same contrite spirit that the woman and the man on the cross went to Christ. Here I am, redeem me, and in that redemption lies allness, fullness, and completeness. If we go to God with some thought, some desire that we would like fulfilled, that is the barrier that will separate us from it. Every time we go to God with some desire, with some need that we want fulfilled, we have provided the barrier that keeps it from us. There can only be one way to go to God. Thy will be done in me. Thy will be done in me that I may be one with Thee, that there may be no barrier within me for Thy light. You see, very quickly this leads you to a revelation that at first will startle, may even disturb, but eventually must be accepted. The God to whom you are praying is within you, closer to you than breathing, and praying out or praying up or praying down is all a waste of time, because the God you are seeking is already within you, and it has a name. It has a name which you must recognize. Otherwise, you will not know the source of the good you are expecting. If you do not know the name of God, and if you do not know the nature of God, you are praying the prayer of idolatry. You are praying to a concept instead of to God. What is a concept? Any idea that you have in mind is a concept. And let us rule out right now that any concept of God that you can entertain can possibly be God. Because remember that any concept you have created. And you cannot create God. You can create many concepts of God, and in one lifetime you can worship a dozen concepts of God, but none of them will be God. And none of them will answer your prayers. Because anything at all that you can entertain in your mind would be too limited, too finite to be God. To pray, then, it is necessary that we rule out every concept of God and accept the revelation of the Master. I am the bread and the meat and the wine and the water. That is the name of God. That is the only name that is closer to you than breathing. That is all there is that is closer to you than breathing, that is incorporeal, spiritual, infinite, the source of all good. I, in the midst of me, am mighty. I, in the midst of me, and the bread, the meat, the wine, and the water. No use of praying out. Acknowledge within. I in the midst of me. I in the midst of me is the source of life, the creative principle of life. I. You see, once you say I, you have no concept. You cannot have a concept of I. No one has ever been able to formulate a concept of I. I is a word that just stands there as myself, but without an explanation, without a concept, without a picture. You cannot draw a picture of I. You cannot even draw a mental picture of I. All you can do is voice I, and there is no thought of what I am. There is only the knowledge that I am. I am, and that is all we know. That is why Lao Tzu told us that if you can name it, it is not God. If you can think it, it is not God. If you can entertain a thought of it, it is not God. Only that is God, which is beyond speech and beyond thought. And when you have gone beyond speech and beyond thought, you have reached God. When you can say, I know not how to pray or what to pray for, let thy spirit bear intercession with my spirit, you are praying spiritually. You are praying the prayer that will be answered. Only be sure you are not praying to something. Be sure you have no idea in mind what God is, or a thought of what God is, or how God functions. For all of this will be finite, limited, idolatrous. No one has seen God face to face. No one will ever see God and live, not in the flesh. To come face to face with God means to be united with God, in God, as God. It is for this reason that any mental attempt to define God, any mental attempt to think of God as a something that can do something, must result disastrously, for there can be no answer. Think for a moment. Think. Is God the all-knowing? Can you accept a God all-knowing? And that means nothing for you to instruct God in. That leaves nothing for you to tell God, for God has been there before you with his knowledge and already knows. Can you accept a God that you need not address, that you need not ask, of whom you need not desire? Because God is infinite intelligence, the all wisdom. Think only. If God could construct this physical universe, how much greater its wisdom must be than ours. We could not even emulate that, and the physical universe is the very least of God's creating. Think. God has formed us in his own image and likeness. And then we look up and tell God what he omitted from us. No, it will not do. Unless you have a God of omniscience, all wisdom, all intelligence, so that when you pray to God, you can say, God, cut my tongue out if I try to talk to you. Let my prayers be with the ears, not with the tongue. Let my prayers be listening, not speaking. Can you accept a God who is divine love? This is asking a great deal. Very few seem capable of accepting a God of divine love, because a God of divine love is forever bestowing, never withholding, ever caring. To accept a God of divine love means that we would cut the tongue out before we would ask God for anything, because we know we would be dishonoring God with the inference, first, that God does not know our need, and secondly, that he is not loving enough to bestow it. Therefore, prayer must be with the ear, not with the tongue. Prayer must be with the ear, and not with the mouth, and not with the thoughts, not with the mind. The mind of man will never reach God in prayer. Unless the mind is still, so that it can be receptive to the still small voice, "Speak, Lord, thy servant heareth." Not thy servant is telling thee, not thy servant is asking thee. Speak, Lord, thy servant heareth. And let prayer be a listening attitude, a receptive state of consciousness, and with it, the desire that what we hear shall transform us and renew us. Not that what we hear shall bring baker's bread or butcher's meat. That which we hear shall transform and renew. That every word we hear shall purify us and make us fit receptacles. Know ye not that ye are the temple of the living God? You know we are not very often. We are only the temple of the living God when we are letting God live our lives, not when we take over and live them. We are the temple of the living God when we let God take over and live our lives, when our prayer is listening, when our attitude is receptivity, when our willingness is to be purified, to be cleansed, to do the will of the Father. This is why the Master, in teaching prayer, said that it profiteth you nothing to pray for your friends. And think how much time we spend praying for our friends and our allies. And it profiteth you nothing. To be children of God, you must pray for your enemies. This is to do the will of God, according to the Master. The will of God is that we pray for our enemies. And you know, we do not do the will of God in that connection enough. In this inner emptiness that we have created through pondering the nature of God and the nature of prayer, we become instruments. We become temples. And then into our consciousness, God pours wisdom and love. It was not absent. It never is. It is only that when we are a vessel already full, full of longings and desires and hopes and ambitions, we are not empty enough to receive God's grace. It is only when we are a state of emptiness that we can receive the grace that is already established within us. Let us for a moment ponder that word grace. Grace is a gift of God. But do not think of grace as something that is given to one individual and withheld from another. Do not think of grace as something you earn or deserve. It is not that at all. Grace is God's gift, which is established within each and every one of us, and which we receive when we are empty. The grace of God is not something that God can bestow on you tomorrow. The grace of God was bestowed upon you in the beginning when you were created in his image and likeness. It was as much a part of you as your integrity or loyalty or fidelity, and you had 100% of those and still have, even though you may not be expressing 100% of them now. They are there within you, 100%, just as they were within the woman taken in adultery and the thief on the cross. Both of these had 100% of integrity within them even while they were committing their crimes. But they were not sufficiently empty to let God's grace, God's purification, flow. So with us, God's grace is established within us. To think otherwise would be a sin. Because if every individual who ever has been, is now, or ever will be, lacks any of God's grace, it must be God's fault. What a terrible indictment that would be to hold against the God of wisdom and the God of love. No, God's grace is within you. The kingdom of God is within you. How could the kingdom of God be within you if the grace of God were not within you? The kingdom of God without the grace of God would not be the kingdom of God. It would be a stable. It would be a place of horror. But the kingdom of God and the grace of God are really synonymous. They are established within you, and they are awaiting your acceptance. The way you accept them is to give up your will, your desire, your wish, your hope, your ambition, and accept God's grace, God's will, God's way. You will find that it is the way of peace, and the way of holiness, and the way of righteousness, the way of harmony, the way of wholeness, the way of completeness, the way of abundance, far beyond our ability to outline. When we have surrendered all our desires and all our wishes and begin to receive God, we will wonder how we could have been so mean with ourselves as to desire only the meager little bit that we have desired in the face of the abundance. Who knows what treasures God has laid up for those who love God? Who knows what treasure God has in store for those who surrender their puny desires, their puny wish and will, and let God's grace be fulfilled? We think sometimes that if we did not pray hard enough for ourselves, our patients, our students, that perhaps they would not get all that is coming to them under God's plan. The contrary is usually true. When we stop the kind of praying that we have heretofore known and surrender ourselves and our patients and our students and our families to God's care, to God's grace, we find that God has a way that we know nothing of. God has a way of bringing His children home, far better ways than we know how to pray about. You see, prayer is the only contact that we can have with God. It is only through prayer that God's grace can reach us. But prayer must be understood. That is why we have these periods of meditation, so that we may clear ourselves of our desires and hopes and longings and wishes, get all of this out of the way. Establish in ourselves, I am satisfied, Father, that Thou art the all-knowing mind. I am satisfied Thou art divine love. I am satisfied Thou art closer to me than breathing. I am satisfied Thou knowest my need before I do. And I am more than satisfied that Thy will be done in me, that Thy grace is my sufficiency in all things. In this contemplative meditation, we cleanse the temple of our human self and human desires, and then when we are sure that we are empty, then begins the real period of prayer, the period in which there are no words and no thoughts, because prayer in its true sense has no words and no thoughts. It is not going to God for anything. It is letting God be revealed to us. Prayer is God's means of reaching us. Prayer is God's means of supplying us. Prayer is God's means of fulfilling Himself in us. And the only attitude of prayer is an empty receptivity. Thy will be done in me. And then be still. Be still and know this. I is God. I in the midst of me. The I that is closer to me than breathing, nearer than hands and feet. Be still and know where God is and what God is. God is the I at the center of your being. Be still and know this. Be still and know that I is the bread and the meat and the wine and the water. Be still and know that I is the resurrection and the life. Be still and know that I is life eternal. Be still and know that I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. I. Try to go up to heaven and leave I behind. Try to go down to hell and leave I behind. Try to walk through the valley of the shadow of death without I going along. You will see, when you recognize God, you will recognize a God of whom you cannot think in terms of thoughts or human limitations. For the word I cannot be defined or understood. I is selfhood, and no one knows what selfhood is, except that it is infinite, omnipresent, omniscient. Be still and know that I, in the midst of me, is the power. Be still and know that no power operates on me from the external world. Not the power of weather, not the power of germs, not the power of a calendar. No power can operate on me from the external. Why? Because I, in the midst of me, is God, and all God's grace flows out. Open out a way, the poet tells us, that the imprisoned splendor may escape. What is the imprisoned splendor but the Spirit of God? The Spirit of God dwells in you. Know ye not that ye are the temple of the living God? Ye are the temple. The kingdom of God is within you. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. I will be with thee unto the end of the world. Is there anything or anybody that will be with you to the end of the world except I? And could you reach any place before or after I? No, always I and my Father are one. The place whereon thou standest is holy ground, because I am there within you. Be still and know. I within you is there, is God, will ever be. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Fear not, it is I. Fear not. It is I, the all-presence, the all-knowing, the all-power, the all-loving. Then let us go about our business each day, and let the Father within do the works. For this I that is within each one of us is the Father that doeth the works. Then we are cleansed, we are purified, we are a vessel that is empty. We have no words, no thoughts, and for a moment, it could be a second, it can be a minute, it could be 5 minutes, we are just receptive, we wait. And whether or not we know it, something takes place. There can be no such thing as a vacuum without it immediately being filled. And this vacuum that we have created by emptying of our finite selves is instantaneously filled with the divine presence, which I am. There are times when we consciously know it and feel it. There are other times when we do not. It is of no importance whether we know it or whether we feel it. It has happened. There can be no such emptying out process without a filling up process, for these are one. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And the moment you have emptied yourself of self, made room for the Spirit is there. You may actually hear those words, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is fulfillment. In the presence of God is fulfillment. Where I am, thou art. And this is fulfillment. The Spirit of God is upon me, and I am ordained to heal the sick. These words are spoken continuously from generation to generation, just as if they were a perpetual tape going out over the air. But they can only be heard, these words. They can only be heard in the silence by those receptive. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. Paul reveals that as creatures you are not under the law of God, neither indeed can be, but when the Spirit of God dwells in you, then do you become the child of God. When does the Spirit of God begin to dwell in you? It has been dwelling within you from everlasting to everlasting, but from the moment of your acknowledgement of it, from the moment of your realization of it, it consciously functions your life. From the moment of your emptiness, and then your realization, fill me, let thy mind be my mind, let thy life be my life, let thy spirit be my spirit, then it takes place, and it is so. Then you come to the form of life again expressed by Paul. I live, yet not I. Christ, the Spirit of God that dwells in me, it lives my life. It is my bread and meat. It is the resurrection unto my body. This Christ, which I have now permitted to consciously enter and express itself, this now is the substance of my life, the substance of my body, the law of my life. I live, yet not I. The Spirit of God that dwells in me, it lives my life. It is my flesh as well as my bread. It is my resurrection. It restores the lost years of the locust. Let me be empty. Let the Lord enter consciously, always with a realization that if there be any faults in me, any hidden faults in me, that I be purified, that I be willing to surrender, and then watch the miracle in transformed lives. Because you are not now a human being who knows some truths. You are now emptied out of being a human being, and you have become divine by virtue of the Spirit of God which dwelleth in you.